Hi, mamas. Welcome to Mental Health Mondays with Reset Brain and Body. I am Carrie Biskolonis, owner of Reset, and here to talk to you about not being a jerk when we end up getting in conflict or having an argument with someone. So, we have talked about anger before, and we talked about ways in which to deal with our anger so we don't actually get to the eruption stage. But let's be honest, most of us do end up losing our cool. And the key here, then, with some of these tips is hopefully to not walk away feeling like, man, I did not handle that well. And I feel worse off now than if I never even confronted this person or ended up having this argument. So I'm going to go through a couple of things just to note and remember when you do go into an argument with someone. And this can be sometimes when we unintentionally react and end up in an argument, or when we're like, okay, I need to have a hard conversation. In my practice, I call those courageous conversations when we know that we have to confront someone and we're feeling nervous about it. And mind you, this is when you're confronting someone that is not a narcissist or manipulative or someone that traditionally gaslights you. This is someone that you can usually have a mutual understanding with. Next week, we'll talk about dealing with manipulative and narcissist people, and I'll give you some tools for that. So, okay, number one tool, and I laugh about this because we've taught my 3-year-old now this rule, and when I do this to him, now he gets mad at me, of course. But number one thing, no interrupting. Right. So when we go to talk to someone and we need to ask them for what they need to share, and we're sharing, setting the ground rules of no interrupting, just need to hear the other one out. Next thing with that, try to hear the other person's point of view. So automatically, our ego gets into defensive mode when we're feeling things that might contribute to us feeling less about ourselves or things that relate to our own self-image. Know that that's just happening biologically. So just try to settle down enough that you can actually hear the person, not just listen, but actually hear their point of view as well. Quiet your inner voice. So a lot of times when we are arguing with someone or we're about to argue, there's like this inner voice that builds a story that makes us angrier perhaps than we need to be. And so checking that and just saying, you know what, I'm not gonna ruminate and overthink things, everything that they're saying. A lot of times when we're arguing, we're waiting to respond by cultivating our response in our head, really try and stay present and just listen to the other person without doing that, because we're really doing ourselves and someone else a disservice. Additionally, remain on topic. So often we end up like grabbing for things from other arguments or that are sometimes unrelated, and we really need to stay on topic in order for our message to come across clearly. Release blame. So, you guys have probably heard of those I and you statements. So, when we go to have an argument, a discussion, a confrontation, we really want to start with I statements versus you statements because that automatically releases the blame. And we are not intended here to act like victims or martyrs or heroes. And so, really saying, I sense, I feel this versus you do this and you do that, right? Automatically, it's a ping finger pointing. And we know how we react when there's a finger pointing in our face, right? We get super defensive. This one's really important. And this is being specific with our needs and our wants. And so, a lot of times we go into an argument or we're reacting and we don't even know what we need or want. We just know that we have a feeling. So we need to be super specific in outlining, this is what I need you to do. This is what I want you to do. This is what I want. This is what I need in order to see change, in order to have this not happen again, et cetera. Because someone wants specific things they can do, but they don't want specific examples. So I go to the next point in which we have to resist the temptation to pull in all of these examples, right? People are like, well, tell me an example. Tell me an example of that. It's like, I don't know. I don't know. It's okay to say, I don't know. I don't know the specifics. I just know that this is something that I've been witnessing. This is something I've been feeling. And this is how I feel. Because when we go to specifics, there's so much more opportunity then to go down the rabbit hole of understanding why that specific event happened, what that person was thinking, what you were thinking. It's like it's a waste of time. Don't go there. So when you are specific, it's about what you want and need going forward versus being specific about examples in the past. Leave that in the past. Just recognize again your feelings. I feel this. I'm noticing this. Resist the triggers, both theirs and yours. So sometimes when we get in arguments, right, it's really easy to like go after the low-hanging fruit. The best one is like, you're acting just like your mother. You're acting just like your father. And that usually sends someone in a tailspin. So just being cognizant not to, you know, do those gut punches. A lot of times when we're arguing, we end up just hitting one after the other, just to make someone feel that much more shameful, that much more disappointing. And all that does is send the other person into a spiral of, you know, low self-worth, despair, and it shuts someone down completely. So really resist the temptation to go after their triggers, and also be recognizing your own triggers, recognizing what they could say to you that's like, ooh, okay, I know that if they say that particular thing, like I'm gonna get really reactive. And so knowing in advance, like where are the areas when you're arguing or someone's confronting you that you get triggered. I already mentioned, don't bring up the past, stay present. And one of the things that we need to remember with this is that we really don't want things to build, right? We want to be able to confront someone and talk about issues as they arise. And the more that we build it up, ruminate, we build that resentment so that when we do share something, someone could be like, I don't even know what you're talking about. Like that happened ages ago, or I really don't feel this way. Versus when we're able to talk to someone right there in the moment, hey, like, what you just did 2 minutes ago, I'm not okay with, or I feel really belittled. I feel dismissed with what just happened. Can we talk about this for a moment? Because the more we address it in the moment, someone's able to say, oh yeah, wow. Okay, I'm so sorry. I didn't mean to do that. I have a pet peeve when someone says, I didn't mean to react. I didn't mean to get angry. I didn't mean to say that. I'm like, ugh, but you did. You did say it. So I have to say right in the moment, hey, you did do that. So it's not that you didn't mean to, you did do it. Can you just say sorry? Because I notice that I have that inner voice that builds and builds and builds. It says like, oh, that's so annoying when they say that. And oh, that makes me so mad. Like, why can't they just be better at responding versus reacting? Why can't they just get, like, I just create this story that then builds up so much more anger and resentment in my system versus in that moment when I'm noticing something, I say, whoa, okay, let's talk about this. Or let's course correct right there, because that building, right? Like you guys all know that feeling in your stomach when you're just like wanting the fire to build and build and you almost like feeling angry, but it's not necessarily going to be the best use of your energy or your mental energy either. So the last point that I'm going to talk about with this is getting curious, because anger is like an iceberg. There is usually a lot more under the surface. So first we have to ask ourselves, what are my anger buttons? You know, what are the things that really set me off? Is it your kids continuing to not listen to you? I know for me, I have now, well, I have a 3.5-year-old and an 8-month-old, and the 8-month-old is crawling all over the place and he wants to play with all of his brother's toys. And what is making me angry lately is when my 3-year-old shoves himself against my 8-month-old to make him not play with his toys. No matter how many times I tell my 3.5-year-old, don't hit your brother, don't push your brother, don't kick your brother, he continues to do it. So I lose my cool, but I know that me yelling and reacting is not going to be the get me the outcome that I want. But just knowing that that is like something that presses my anger button helps me then get more curious, find more awareness to then respond versus react in a way that I want. And trust me, sometimes my 3-year-old just needs to be yelled at. Sometimes that all it is. Okay, so ask yourself, what are your anger buttons? And really get curious about different people, different situations, different times of day. And ask yourself too, okay, what can I do instead? What can I tell myself so I'm not reacting in the moment? So often anger comes from a place of they're doing this to me and I'm taking it personally. Because then what happens is that augments our own story about ourselves, our own limiting beliefs, our own shame stories. I have a client who every time her husband vacuums in front of her, she's like, he's basically just saying I'm lazy. He's just saying I'm lazy and I'm worthless, and it totally exacerbates my shame story, and I just feel like a complete pile of nothing sitting there on the couch when all I'm trying to do is relax. Because she already has this story of her husband's a busybody, he likes to do, he vacuums every time that she's in the room when she's just trying to relax. She feels like he's trying to tell her a message. And 9 times out of 10, that's not the case. It's our own story. So again, what can I tell myself instead when my anger button is pressed? Like, this isn't about me. This is not something that I need to take personal. They're not doing this to me. My 3-year-old doesn't have the ability to be manipulative. So reframing those stories that it instantly come up when we notice that our anger buttons are being pushed. We also have to get curious about, why did I explode? How did I get to this point where the explosion happened, that huge reaction happened? And a lot of times you're not able to do that until after you calm down and you're like, oh wow, I need to be reflective on this. How did I let it get this bad? Was it because I was building and building and building and not communicating my needs in the moment more often? Was it because I haven't eaten yet today? Was I actually hangry? Was it because I'm hormonal? Like, so many different things, but just asking yourself, what got me to this point? And then the other thing to get curious about is, how do I know when I'm getting angry? What are the cues? Where do I feel it in my body? Do I notice that fire burning in my belly? Do I notice that my hands are starting to get tense? Do I notice the top of my head fuming? Do I notice it anywhere else, like neck tension, shoulder tension? So getting those signs from your body to then say, whoa, okay, I'm noticing that buildup happening and I need to figure out how to do something about it. And again, we've talked about how to deal with anger in one of the previous videos, but finding those things that you can do to help yourself cool off either before or after the explosion. But hopefully these tips today help you in how to actually have a productive argument, how to feel like not a jerk when you're done with the argument, and of course, getting curious about, why is this even making me angry? What needs do I need to have met that aren't being met right now? Where do I need to take this a little bit further in some self-discovery? Why is my shame story being triggered? What is it about this message I have about myself that's making me even angry and needing to bring this up? So next week, we'll talk about dealing with narcissists and manipulative people, because they are definitely difficult to have difficult conversations with. Stay tuned, especially as we get into holidays. You might be experiencing more and more of those people. So drop any questions or comments into the chat area. But again, I am Carrie with Reset Brain and Body here in Michigan, always available for you both online and in person for counseling. We offer integrative services, so please reach out to us if you or someone in your family needs a little bit of help, or maybe even before they need that help. So actually, one comment I want to address real quick. I've noticed that if I wait, it builds up, and I definitely create my own story, for sure. I do the same thing. I think a lot of people do, and so it's really important to know what that story is, so that we can catch ourselves and say, oh, okay, this is my story. This is my limiting belief. This is my shame talking. This is my trauma being re-triggered versus something that is actually legitimate and valid in that moment. So thank you guys so much. Always lovely having you here for Mental Health Mondays. Take care.